Hello friends, I have a very exciting new lens to share with you today. Sigma just announced this 150 to 600 millimeter f5 to 6.3 DGDNOS sports lens for E and L mounts. It's Sigma's first ultra telephoto zoom lens engineered specifically for mirrorless full frame cameras. It is in the sports line, which means that it's quick with great optical quality. I've been using the Sony version for a week ahead of launch, and I'll share my thoughts and my results with you today. If you're new here, welcome. My name is Lee, and I share videos every week on anything where you might have a camera in your hand, including gear reviews like this one. I also have complete courses for those of you that want to go in depth on photography topics with me. So subscribe if that sounds appealing to you, and check the link in the description to learn more about channel membership to see those courses. Let me give you my overall opinion, and then we will get into details and more photos and videos. If you use Sony E or Leica, Panasonic, or Sigma L mount bodies, and you need a lens that will go all the way to 600 millimeters, this one is an excellent choice. And while I tested the lens on my Sony E mount body, the Alpha 7R 4, I am purchasing it for L mount as soon as it's available. In fact, if I didn't already own this Sony 200 to 600 millimeter lens, I'd say that I would have gone with the Sigma lens, but I'll talk more about that later, why you may prefer one over the other, along with how this lens also compares to Tamron's new and very interesting 150 to 500 millimeter lens for E mount. First, image quality. Sigma says that this lens has superior rendering throughout the entire zoom range at all apertures, which I agree with, and it is impressive. I could tell you about the 25 elements in the lens, but really that doesn't mean much of anything. It's really how those elements work together that matters. In the real world, I spent a lot of time at 600 millimeters and f6.3, which is the longest focal length and the widest aperture available at that focal length. If there was going to be a quality issue anywhere, it would be there. I saw zero issues. The clarity is stellar. And beyond clarity, the way the lens transitions from in focus to out of focus is pleasing. It's a smooth transition that isn't distracting. And the bokeh itself is smooth. It looks natural, and again, it isn't distracting at all. So image quality is great, but I would expect nothing less from Sigma. So let's look at the lens itself and how usable it is. It does have some convenient features on board that you should see. While the range of the lens is 150 to 600 millimeters and it is designed for full frame bodies, you can certainly use it on APS-C bodies. When you do that, you end up with an effective focal length range of 225 to 900 millimeters. I made use of APS-C mode on my Alpha 7R 4 while shooting video so that I could get a tighter shot of this coyote. I was still able to capture the footage in 4K, but I appeared to be more zoomed in. This brings us to some more of the usability options on the lens. There are programmable buttons on the lens. I happen to have mine set to switch from full frame to APS-C mode so that I can quickly zoom in, for lack of a better phrase, while capturing video. Another popular use for these buttons is to make them a focus hold, which can also be helpful. Speaking of focus, you can see that there is a relatively narrow focus ring here. Sometimes when I am having trouble with autofocus, like I did with this dragonfly, I switch it over to manual focus quickly. I was initially concerned that the focus ring would be too narrow for my liking, but it isn't. At least in part because it and the zoom ring actually both have a good amount of texture. Plus it is rubbery and well damped, so it isn't too easy to turn. It makes it easy to find the focus ring without having to take my eye away from the viewfinder and look, and then fine tune my focus. Back over to these switches, you also see a focus limiter switch with three options. This can definitely make you faster in the field. You are telling your camera to only try to achieve focus within a certain distance from the camera. And then the optical stabilization options, you have two plus off. I do turn this off when I have the camera on a tripod, but option one is for general handheld shooting and option two is for panning. Either way, you do have up to four stops of optical stabilization, which is very helpful, for example, in this situation, as the light was getting low and I was shooting handheld. Because my subject was all but still, I was able to lower my shutter speed a bit and still capture a crisp image. And then the next switch is the custom switch. This allows you to program a combination of optical stabilization and focus limiting. And one last switch on this lens is the zoom torque switch. This allows you to lock the zoom ring in place or set it to have more or less tension as you zoom. So while walking around, it's nice to have a minimally tense zoom ring for quick zooming, or if you prefer to use your zoom push-pull style. But that can also mean that you experience zoom creep if you hold the lens front side down. If that bugs you, or you simply like a tighter zoom ring, you can make it so. The lens still zooms, it just takes a little bit more effort to turn the ring. Also on the lens is a very nice tripod collar and foot. The collar clicks into place every 90 degrees, which is handy when you're in a hurry, and the foot is not only sturdy, but it also has a dovetail so that it's ARCA compatible. Another sturdy part of this lens is the hood. It is thick and it also has a tension screw rather than twisting into place, which not only means that it is significantly more difficult to accidentally bump the hood off of the lens, but it also provides a fair amount of protection for the front element. The lens itself weighs 4.6 pounds or 2100 grams. That's not insignificant, but I used it handheld the vast majority of the time. I do have a video where I discuss my tips for managing a large telephoto lens handheld. If you're interested, I will link to it in the description. But between practice handholding a large lens and the stabilization in the lens and in body image stabilization, it's a completely manageable lens. You know what? Even if you don't have in body image stabilization. A quick note on range. If you purchase this lens for L mount, it is compatible with the two Sigma teleconverters. They are 1.4x and 2x. Again, those are only for L mount, but they will extend your maximum focal length to 840 millimeters and 1200 millimeters respectively. Those teleconverters do limit your available apertures, so consider the conditions under which you typically shoot, but it's a great option, and it may allow you to capture photos that you would not otherwise be able to capture. I did use both of those teleconverters with the Sigma 100 to 400 millimeter lens last year, I believe, and I was impressed with their performance. I will link to that video in the description if you want to hear a little bit more about those teleconverters and how the aperture of your lens gets reduced when using them. And a last note on aperture. While I said that the range is f5 to 6.3, we can't forget how those available apertures are spread over the zoom range of the lens. At 150 millimeters, the lens is able to open up to f5, but then it jumps to f5.6 at 175 millimeters, and then makes the jump to f6.3 at about 366 millimeters. And I was surprised to see that it took that long in the zoom range to get to f6.3. Honestly, I spend the majority of my time with a lens like this at the longest focal length, so I simply appreciate that I have f6.3 at 600 millimeters, but when utilizing the slightly shorter focal lengths, you retain more light for longer in the range. Now, autofocus and tracking and detection are largely a function of the camera body, but the lens does need to keep up. If your lens is sluggish, it doesn't really matter how fast your camera is, right? So with this lens, it contains a redesigned autofocus system with a stepping motor and a high precision magnetic sensor. And like I said about the number of lens elements, information like the type of autofocus motor is nice, but it's really how it works in the field that matters. And in this case, autofocus did keep up with my Alpha 7 R4 in all situations. And with cameras getting faster and better, this is actually a very important note. This lens is also dust and splash resistant. I did have it out in the very hot and dusty desert and in the rain. Of course, your camera also needs to be weather sealed, but it is one less thing to worry about when taking this lens out in the field. And a last note on usability is the minimum focusing distance. It's wild. This lens will focus at less than 23 inches or 58 centimeters at 150 millimeters. I actually had to lift my face away from the camera every time I got closer to this flower to make sure that I didn't bump the lens into it. Your working distance ends up being very close. And this simply gives you options. I might be photographing a coyote in the distance, but then turn around and want to photograph a nice wildflower right next to me. And I appreciate that kind of freedom. Okay, let's do a quick review of the other options for super telephoto lenses for both E and L mount bodies. Starting with L mount, there are no other 600 millimeter options. Leica makes a 90 to 280 millimeter lens that is fantastic, but nowhere near 600 millimeters. The longest lens out there for L mount is the Sigma 100 to 400, which you can technically add a teleconverter to, but like I mentioned, then you're limiting your available aperture. This 150 to 600 has the best aperture for the focal length. For E mount, there are a couple 100 to 400 millimeter lenses, one by Sigma, one by Sony, both with teleconverters available. Again, though, we have that issue with apertures. However, there are two other lenses, the Sony 200 to 600, f5.6 to 6.3 OSSG, I own this, and Tamron just released this 150 to 500 millimeter f5 to 6.7 DI3 VC XVD, which I have in for testing right now. Both of these lenses are great. The Tamron is shorter, but it only reaches to 500 millimeters at a widest aperture of f6.7, and it's only slightly less costly than the Sigma. I am really just now getting into testing this lens, but I'm gonna have a hard time recommending it over the Sigma lens. Stay tuned for that review though. It is a smaller lens and I'm not counting it out yet. And as for comparing this lens to the Sony 200 to 600, this is largely gonna be a matter of personal preference. The Sony lens is quite a bit longer, but it also doesn't extend as you zoom, which some people might prefer. The Sony lens also jumps to f6.3, slightly earlier in the zoom range. It has a much longer minimum focusing distance. And two items, the tripod foot and the hood are definitely not as robust as Sigma's. You can see I replaced the tripod foot on my Sony lens. And last, the Sony lens is about $500 more expensive than the Sigma. I did do one side-by-side comparison for image quality of these two lenses at 600 millimeters at the widest aperture and found zero difference in clarity. So this truly is a matter of personal preference. Do you prefer the more compact size and lower price of the Sigma or the lack of extension while zooming and OEM brand of the Sony? This lens is expected to be available in late August of this year for a price of $1,499 in the US. Like I said at the beginning of this video, I will be purchasing this for L mount. I do own a couple of L mount bodies, the Leica SL2 and the Panasonic S5. I've been saying for a while that I was hoping for a super telephoto lens for L mount. Sigma definitely exceeded my expectations here. This lens will be a great fit for my L mount bodies. And I will certainly share more about that journey once the lens is available for purchase and I get it back into my grubby mitts. For now, I have to send this guy back to Sigma and wait patiently for my copy. Now, let me know what you think in the comments. Does this lens entice you? What camera do you use that you want to use it with? And let me know if you have any questions as well. Thank you to Sigma for allowing me to try out this lens, and thank you for watching.